A very good morning to everyone. I, Dr. Vagisha Rawal from Department of Zoology, welcome you all to the Symposium on Wildlife Conservation Challenges, Efforts and Scope. We don't own the planet Earth. We belong to it and we must share it with our wildlife. As rightly expressed by Steve Irwin, somehow underlines the importance and the need of wildlife conservation and management at once. Crowned as the most intelligent animal, humans have directly or indirectly marched such steps which promoted their comfortable survival with all the amenities, while turning a blind eye to the rest of the creatures that inhabit this planet too. Being in the 21st century with all the advancements around us, with new developments being made every day, we have spilled the concrete monsters over all the landforms. Such one development has surely impacted the wildlife and the nature it inhabited, up to a point that many more species are on the line of being endangered or even worse off being extinct. In such a scenario, wildlife conservation becomes extremely important. In the time which we are living in, sustainable development is the goal for the future for all the resources that would support human survival. But it should be noted that conserving wildlife will also help us with sustainable growth, as it would keep the ecological balance in harmony. With these lines, I would like to start today's event. Now I request convener Dr. Om Prakash to share a few words about the symposium.
Okay, thank you, Vagisha.
Sir, I would like to hand over the screen to you.
Thank you, Dr. Vagisha. Wildlife is not just a game to be hunted, rather a gift to be nurtured. The main aim of conducting this symposium on such a topic is to bring focus to the heads that are deeply engrossed in the idea of development, that the thought of conserving our nature and the wildlife has somewhat been lost. Wildlife conservation directly aims to safeguard the flora and fauna. As the human population encroaches on the resources provided by them, it becomes important for us to learn the concept of maintaining a balance between our needs and nature's stability. As the human enterprise expanded in the recent years, numerous wildlife habitats have been shrinked. A lot of efforts have been made in the past, but still wildlife is not completely shielded. The existing system of national parks, wildlife sanctuaries, biosphere reserves is still not adequate for the fauna conservation. Protection under the human care appears to be only remedy. The prudence demands that we should escalate our efforts so that the least we are able to save some of the fragments of our wildlife for the future. Raising the political awareness and mobilizing support for conservation of natural resources and wildlife shall achieve little until and unless fundamental policy needed to ensure the conservation is well defined. People may be prepared to act, but they should know what to do. Therefore, mankind should be made concerted efforts to minimize the projected loss of biodiversity. No doubt we shall lose significant part of our biological wealth, but what is important today is what we are able to save. The symposium aims at maintaining the elements of diversity, restoring wildlife, and integrating nature's restoration requirements with human needs, and with the hope to develop scientific temper, humanism, and spirit of reform. With this, I request Dr. Vagisha Rawal to take up the stage and start the event.
Thank you so much, sir. A very good morning to everyone once again. I feel extremely honored to introduce our first speaker of the day, Mr. Surinder Mehra, who is presently posted as Deputy Inspector General at NCTA, National Tiger Conservation Authority. We are very grateful to Mr. Surinder Mehra for accepting our invitation and making his virtual presence here. Sir, it is my great pleasure to introduce you. Mr. Surinder Mehra is a member of Indian Forest Service of 1999 batch. He graduated as Bachelor of Technology in Electronics and Telecommunication Engineering from Regional Engineering College, Kurukshetra, and he served in Indian Engineering Services before joining IFS in 1999. He received Uttaranchal State Forestry Award in 2003 for excellence in civil services reforms. He received PG Diploma in Wildlife Management from Wildlife Institute of India, Dehradun in 2007. He also holds a PG Diploma in Environmental Law from National Law School, Bangalore. He has worked as Deputy Conservator for Forest Haldwani, Corbett Tiger Reserve and Rajaji National Park and Rudraprayag. He has also worked as faculty in Central Academy for State Forest, Dehradun. In recent years, he worked as Conservator of Forest, Western Circle, Haldwani and Chief Conservator of Forest and Field Director, Corbett Tiger Reserve. He has written first management plan of Nandhaur Wildlife Sanctuary. He successfully conducted the wildlife monitoring study in Western Circle and also authored his report titled Status of Tigers, Habitats and Corridors in Western Circle, Uttarakhand. His field of interest are wildlife management, legal issues in forest and wildlife, wildlife technology, GIS and remote sensing and wildlife photography. He has also authored two books titled Legal Forestry in 2004 and Study and Practice of Wildlife Laws in India 2010. He is presently posted as Deputy Inspector General NCTA, National Tiger Conservation Authority, New Delhi. I would like to hand over the screen to Mr. Surendra Mehraji. But before that, there is one important announcement. When talk ends, participants can get a chance to directly interact with our speaker. They can raise their hand if they want to ask any question. Then question directly will be taken by our speaker. Thank you. Have a great day and I hope you will enjoy his talk. Now, sir, you can take over the screen.
Okay, thank you very much, Vagisha, for introduction and introducing today's symposium also. In fact, it is very important, this the whole topic. And the interesting thing about this topic is that there are many questions which are unanswered in the mind of not only in the mind of general public, but also in the mind of experts, especially people who are associated with media or political system or even academicians. So in this background, I think this topic or this subject is very relevant, and it becomes more relevant because we'll be talking to the students who are basically ultimately will make a viewpoint on various aspects or with various social or economic issues in the coming years for the country. So I have a presentation. I think start with that. My screen is visible to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir, it's visible.
Okay, thank you very much. So this is basically about what are the challenges in tiger conservation in general. In specific, I will talk about this topic. But when I'm talking about challenges or management challenges in tiger conservation, I'm also talking about or in general, you can say the conservation per se, the challenges which are faced by not only country but by the whole world as far as conservation is concerned. So if we talk about our country, when we associate ourselves with the wildlife, with forest or with any natural aspect or the nature directly, there are many backgrounds to that. One background which is very important in Indian context is culture and mythology. In our culture and mythology, we have always been associated with the wildlife or forest or animal species. Faith is very important. Many people people believe that there are many gods which are there, basically are associated with certain animals like owl, or for that matter peafowl, or any other many species, or even snake. So going to the bit background in the initial days or prehistoric time, or after during the recent history, or in the ancient history also, people around their habitations, they had sacred groves. So it was not like that everyone was basically extracting the materials or extracting the resources from the forest directly with no restriction on that. So sacred grove is one thing which started with the initial human development. And when there was basically a different set of habitat or habitation, you can say, for the human being and for the wild animals. So people try to keep a space for wild animal, which was basically a kind of space which was there in between the human habitations and the real wilderness area. So these places were known as sacred groves. People never used to go there for hunting, or maybe for cutting the trees. So these were the aspects which were there, and there were some customary regulations, because there were no law in the initial human development days. So people, they themselves, especially in India, they themselves had certain customary regulations. General restraints from exploitation of wild plants or animals, maybe through the concept of faith, and they themselves had customary regulation like not to hunt particular animal of a particular sex at a particular stage of life or in a particular season. So these self-regulation was there in historical times. And many a time we also talk, even current days also, we talk about something called self-regulation. And all our laws, all our regulations or rules which are there in books are not being followed. So people in current scenario also talk about self-regulation. So ultimately, when in a society this kind of customary or the self-regulation is very important, which was there in Indian society in historical times. So what happened after that, when if you go into the history, during the medieval period or to prehistoric time, and there was lots of invasions in country, and that was the time when there was large scale extermination of wildlife by the Mughals, and not only Mughals but the monarchs of the princely states also, and later on which was done by the British also. So it is not only the invaders or the people who came for the commercial activity, especially from the European countries who came to India as a colonizer. Even the local princes or the kingdoms, they also were responsible for extermination of the wildlife during the medieval period. This is just a figure, some of you must have read this. Maharaja of Sarguja, in his lifetime, he had shot 1,116 tigers, a big figure. Even if you talk about 1,000 figure of tiger, which is basically one third of the population of tigers in our country. So there are a little more than 3,000 tigers or 3,500 tigers in our country. So he himself killed these many tigers. So you can understand the population of tiger at the time. Not only the population, the more important is that the kind of forest we had during that time. Okay, so there are many aspects to the present state of wildlife. It was not only the exploitation of forest, but also the explosion of population also. The population of country increased day by day, and the level which we are here is very difficult to to manage the forest and keep the faunal diversity of the country intact. During the British time, there were many concepts which came into play. Like initially, when the one of the organizers, he was talking about the game. This is very important to understand what is game. Basically, if you see in Europe or in America, in those continents, if you see the concept of conservation of wildlife management, all this, it came from the concept of game management. Game management is nothing but you are managing a particular area where you have animals. You are managing the population of animals on the basis of a criteria called carrying capacity. And in that particular area, you are not thinking about the self-regulation of the ecological system. You are talking about the regulation through human interference. Like, there are many places where you don't have prey-predator relationship because there is no prey, predator. Only prey species are there. So in those areas, you have to regulate the population. And in countries like Africa, where you have lots of wildlife, in those areas also many areas are managed on the concept of game. So during the British time, the protection was given to certain areas. Like, it was the British time only when in India we started the concept of national parks and wildlife sanctuaries. In 1936, when the first national park of country, which was known as Haley National Park, was constituted, and basically there were certain areas which Britishers thought that this should be a special control or regulation on these areas, which should be restricted only to the British people. And these were basically the areas where these people used to do the hunting. And Britishers, as well as the princely states owners, all these people, they used to do the hunting. And some of you are aware about Bharatpur, which is basically a Ramsar site also, a beautiful wetland. These many geese and birds, geese and ducks were killed during 1930s by a single person. So that was basically kind of a resource which we had in form of natural resources, in form of faunal diversity during that time also. So this was the time when the maximum destruction happened as far as the natural resources is concerned, because it was not only the wild animal for the game hunting, but the forest also. During the British time, most of the forest area where we had a very good forest as far as timber quality is concerned. Many forest areas were converted into agriculture, and many forest areas were converted into monoculture also. All the mixed species were cut down and monoculture were raised for the commercial purposes. If you go into the background, even after independence, and that was the time when India started thinking about the economic development and social upliftment also, because at the time of independence also, India's population was we were quite big in size as compared to other countries. The main concern of country was to have enough food grain for the countrymen. So that was the time when we, in 1950s, we started a program called Grow More Food. So this was the time when lots of forest areas were converted into agricultural fields, and all these forest areas were mainly the areas which were very productive. If some of you are aware about some area like called Tarai area of foothills of Himalayas, all along foothills of Himalayas, because this Tarai area is fed by the Himalayan rivers. So this area is very, very productive. So whole of this area, many stretches from this area were converted into agricultural field. And all these tribal peoples, those who were there, the local inhabitants, even they could not convert those areas into agricultural field, and that's why we have a very important role of Sikh people from Punjab. All along the Rai area, you will find lots of Sikh people who came there and they converted those areas into agricultural field. And some of you must be surprised that why Sikh people could establish those areas in agriculture. This is very important, in fact, point in the history that these were the people in Punjab, those who faced most of the invasion from Mughals. And that's why it is said that the people living in Punjab or Sikh people, they are very hardy people. And that's why they could survive in totally hostile conditions of Tarai forest, which was totally basically infested with mosquitoes and lots of malaria. And many people, thousands of people died during that time when all these forests were converted into agricultural field. But still, we have quite a good chunk of forest there in Tarai landscape also. So it is basically, this was the basically background when after independence also, we had to, because of our requirements, we had to convert lots of forest area into agricultural field or other activities or horticulture also sometimes. So in 70s, when lots of initiatives were taken at the international level, all of you must be aware that whenever it is the talk of conservation at international level also, India is basically pioneering a country. India is basically a signatory to, I think, nearly 100% treaties which are there at international level, which talks about conservation of biodiversity, conservation of wild animals, conservation of wetlands. So in 1917, there were certain initiatives which were taken at international level. And that was the time when a very important program in India was launched as far as wildlife is concerned, or wildlife conservation is concerned. That is known as Project Tiger in 1973 by the visionary Prime Minister Mrs. Indira Gandhi. And at the same time, one more thing happened at that time. In 1972, the first legislation which is totally dedicated to wildlife conservation or wildlife protection, that is the Wildlife Protection Act, it was enacted in 1972. So both the things started side by side, because when you are starting a program, there will be some legal backing also. But still, the project area were not a legal entity at that time. So in 1973, Project Tiger started with the 9 tiger reserves, and it started from a well-known tiger reserve of the country, that is Corbett National Park. That was the first Project Tiger area of, and which was taken under the Government of India scheme. And the basic vision of this program was to ensure the maintenance of a viable population of tiger in country for scientific, economic, and aesthetic, cultural, and ecological value. So this was the vision behind the program. And the main purpose of this program was to fund the state governments. It was basically a funding mechanism by the central government to the state governments. And all these areas which were brought under the Project Tiger ambit were funded by the Government of India for the management. And if you talk about the present status, in fact, this figure is not 50 now. At present, we have 51 tiger reserve. One tiger reserve is recently notified, maybe around 20 days back, in the state of Tamil Nadu, which is known as Srivilpattur Meghamalai Tiger Reserve, which is basically adjoining to this Periyar Tiger Reserve, which is there in Kerala. And there are 18 tiger range states. The tiger range state means the states which are having tiger population in country, and around 2.21% of total country's areas is under Project Tiger scheme or under the ambit of network of tiger reserves. What was the impact of this program? This impact was huge. And all of you are aware that India is now having 70% of the global population of tiger, which is around 3,000. From my personal experience, it is more than 3,000. The population in our country is basically between 3,000 to 4,000, because exact number you can never detect, because there are many areas where which are inaccessible, and the science is also it's on restriction to exact number, because you are not able to find the exact number of human population also. So it is very difficult to find the exact number of population of tiger in wild. Some of the more important things which are about the tiger reserves and the landscapes or the ecosystems which have tiger reserve is basically these tiger reserves are basically the storehouse of carbon also, because tiger reserves, they conserve the forest stock. Ultimately, wherever the tiger is there, the forest is good, and the forest is good, you are having a good forest stock. So basically it's an ecosystem which otherwise also provides certain ecosystem services. When we talk about ecosystem services, carbon sequestration in current scenario, when we talk about climate change, when we talk about so many other things, increasing temperature, decreasing glacier extents. So all these things, when we are talking about the carbon sequestration, is very important. And all these tiger reserves or the landscapes which are having tiger are important carbon sequestration areas. And this is very interesting fact that more than 350 rivers, these rivers, they originate from tiger reserves. So out of these 51 tiger reserves, there are 350 major rivers, major and minor rivers, they originate from tiger reserve. So that from that point of view also, these tiger reserves or the tiger landscape is very important, not only from the conservation point of view, for basically social and economic development of the country also. Tiger number after 2006 are having an increasing trend. Definitely the type of management or the concentration of management has increased over a period of time. When in 2006 the National Tiger Conservation Authority was constituted, and it was given the statutory status under the provisions of Wildlife Protection Act. With this background, with the basic idea about the Project Tiger, basic idea about the past management in historical times, now let us see some of the issues which are very important from tiger conservation point of view. And these are the issues which are not only the issues, but they are the challenges. And they are not very simple challenges. They are very big challenges. And the most important is the habitat or the landscape fragmentation. All of you know that when these animals or faunal diversity which is there in the forest areas, they need space to move out. And when they species like tiger, they are territorial animal, but otherwise also other species like elephant, they need big landscapes to move from one area to another area. Tiger may be a territorial animal, but at the same time, when elephant moves in forest area, they move large distances. So you need large fragments or large habitats or large landscapes which are undisturbed. Okay. So many times we link it with sourcing also, though I personally don't believe in that theory that there are certain areas which are basically national parks and sanctuaries, they act as source, and other areas they act as sink. So basically for animals, there is nothing called source and sink. They go wherever they find the forest area. And when they don't find out a forest, then they start moving out of the forest to habitations also. And the second thing is ecologically unsustainable land uses in tiger landscape. And this is also very important for the loss of connectivity. You don't have to very big forest, continuous big forest. But if you have big forest in big patches, and there are certain small patches which are basically there in form of corridors, which connect a big landscape with another big landscape. So these areas, small strips are called corridors. But if there are unsustainable land uses in tiger landscape, these corridors, then there is a loss of connectivity. And what are these unsustainable land uses? Maybe for conversion of agriculture also, because previously we said that forest got depleted due to the conversion of forest into agriculture. Now we are saying, because this, now when we talking about connectivity for the animals to move from one forest area to another forest area, all these agricultural field or maybe semi-agricultural field in form of so-called wastelands, these are very important for connecting different forest areas. So unsustainable uses like road network, rail network, or some big industrial hub. So all these activities are the activities or conversion of any horticulture landscape into a landscape, like if anyone has been there in Cobra Tiger Reserve for a tourism visit, then you must find that you will be finding that there are lots of resorts which have come up along the Kosi River. So all these areas were basically horticulture area previously. So now because of all these resorts, the animals are not able to move. But previously when there were horticulture fields, the horticulture is nothing like a semi-forest habitat. So animals were able to move from one area to another area. So these are certain unsustainable land use practices which are basically responsible for loss of connectivity. Man-tiger conflict, very crucial and very hot topic these days, because you'll most of the time you must be seeing the tiger has come out of the forest area, it is moving in the habitation area. So there are many reasons, and we will discuss a bit in detail about this also. Poaching and trafficking, country like China or other countries where the animals and animal products are sold, and because of some myths and because of so many other reasons, the animals are poached and are sent to different countries for the purpose of all these myths, for the purpose of traditional medicine, and for the purpose of for the recreation also. Okay, many people, they keep the animals for as a pet also. You'll be surprised to know that the maximum number of tigers which are found in basically captivity is USA. So they have more than 4,000 tigers which are there in captivity in USA. So they keep those animals as pet. Maybe the origin was also captive. But in general, to say that this is also one of the reasons why animals are traded. Lack of local support. Many times you don't get local support. Forest department, they face lots of a problem as far as the local support is concerned. Insufficient resources is another issue for tiger source area. Just a minute. Mm-hmm. Am I able to still share the presentation?
Yes, sir, it's there.
Okay, so basically all these things ultimately lead to the insufficient resource. Insufficient resource means
Excuse me, sir. Your slides are not changing. I mean, you are stuck only when we can see.
Project Tiger slide is there right now.
Yeah.
Oh, can you? Is it coming now?
I think, sir, you can like stop sharing and reshare the presentation once again.
Oh my God!
Actually, we thought that.
Stop sharing. So please tell me immediately if you find this problem. Okay. You are able to see this now?
Sir,
habitat landscape fragmentation?
Yes.
Okay, so this is one slide which shows that how the habitats or the landscape is fragmented, and all these development activities, they play a very important role in loss of connectivity of forest areas, and ultimately restrict the movement of wild animals. These are some of the pictures which are taken from very important tiger landscape and elephant landscape of Kaziranga. So this is one aspect, and why we talk about the landscape. I have already discussed that animal, tiger, they move lots of area. This particular tiger, which was radio collared in Maharashtra, we could see that this tiger could travel more than 1,000 kilometers. That's why we should understand why we need the landscapes, big landscapes for protection of a particular species. If you were talk about species conservation. And this is just to tell you about the concept of corridor, which I told you in last slide. What are corridors basically? If you are able to see this slide, can you see this slide with the two arrows? So basically, this is basically. Are you able to see this slide with two arrows?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is basically a Google map from a landscape of Rajaji National Park. This side is the Rajaji National Park on the lower side of the slide, and on the northeast side of the slide, you have Dehradun Forest Reserve. And all these white areas are habitations. And these are basically narrow patches of forest or narrow strips of forest, which connect two big forests, two big habitats. So these are known as corridors. And this is what we are talking about, the connectivity. The loss of connectivity should not be there. And this is a national highway. This blue line is a national highway. So if connectivity is there, no problem. But if the connectivity is disturbed by the by some developmental activity or the linear infrastructure, especially road, the animals won't be able to move out. Then what will happen? All these animals which could have gone to this area for in search of water or fodder, what they will do? They will start moving to villages. That will ultimately lead to there are many areas which I told you that due to our practices, like this was the area. This is river Ganga in Rajaji National Park, and this is eastern western side of Rajaji National Park. And on this side, on the right hand side, you have eastern side of Rajaji National Park. And this was the only patch which was left as connectivity. But in 70s, this area was diverted for the non-forestry activity. And later on, when we realized in 80s and 90s, then we shifted this village. This village was basically a village. This is a rehabilitated village, which was there for the people outside of Tehri Dam. So people from Tehri Dam area were rehabilitated here. Now again, these people have been shifted from this area to another area to create this recreate this corridor. And this area was transferred to army for ammunition dump after Chinese war. So these are certain activities or certain incidences which have happened in past, but ultimately which has led to conflict. So this is very important to have the connectivity of the landscape. The ideal thing is you should have big landscapes, but if you don't have big landscape or big habitats, then you should have good connectivity between the landscape. This is what I was talking about, an example from Corbett Tiger Reserve. If you see this river, this is Kosi River, this is Corbett Tiger Reserve, and this is Ramnagar Forest Region. And all along this Kosi River, these are different villages. Previously, all these villages, they used to have very good horticulture in their fields. So all this area was famous for the horticulture, especially mangoes and lychee. So when tourism started happening in big way in Corbett, then all these areas were converted into this resorts. People, they sold out their land to private people to establish resorts. And all these small, if you concentrate on this slide, you can see all these small blue patches. In all this area, these are nothing but the swimming pools of all these resorts. So this is how the connectivity is lost. So these are very important. So now the connectivity is from this part, which is on the north extreme part of Corbett Tiger Reserve. With that connectivity is still there, but that area is partly enclosed. So all these areas were very important, and these are the activities which ultimately lead to loss of connectivity in these areas. And of course, ultimately, the local people, they have to face the brunt, because they are the people who live in surrounding of all these areas. And basically, ultimately, if you talk about the conservation, this I would say is many time local people or the people those who are facing the problem are also not wrong. Because if you see, as an outsider or as a city dweller, we go to any national park or a sanctuary for recreation, nothing but recreation most of the time. Where there are very few people, maybe less than 1%, who go there to appreciate the nature or appreciate the forest. Because most of the time when we go to forest, we always look for tiger, any big mammal which is there in that particular national park. And because of conservation efforts in past, definitely the population has increased, the animal population has increased. And what has happened because of loss of this connectivity, the animals, they have started coming out also in search of food, in search of space also, because tiger is a territorial animal. And all these areas which are there around tiger reserves are very fertile areas. And all along this Tarai area, because these are very fertile area, and I told you that most of the rivers, they originate from tiger reserve. These areas are fertile, so they are basically growing the fast-growing species or of agriculture, especially sugarcane. So sugarcane fields which are adjoining to forest area are basically literally a semi-forest habitat for these tigers. So the spillover population which is there in a tiger reserve, they move to this agriculture field. And sugarcane field or this piece, this particular crop, this requires least maintenance also. You don't have to go to sugarcane field. Once it is grown, then it will go for 2-3 cycles. So these are the area which are otherwise also not don't have the human presence also. So all these areas become very good space for the tigers to go out. And many a time tiger breed also. So whenever by chance any word goes inside this sugarcane field which are there around these tiger reserves, they come in encounter with the tiger, and many people, they get killed or they get injured also. So this is very important aspect. Now we are trying to many a time we have two certain, we have tried to engage with the local people to go for the change in crop or some other crop, so that the animals, they don't go in the agriculture field just because they see sugarcane as a forest habitat. But many a time it becomes very difficult to manage whenever they go in the field, because it is very difficult to, you can manage tiger or you can manage wild animal, you can tranquilize wild animal, but it is very difficult to manage the local people, those who gather there. It is very difficult to manage the mob. Most of the time we have to take help of police department to manage the crowd or mob. You must have seen many videos, people are just driving away elephant, people are driving away leopard. People just go crazy whenever they see an animal. This top photograph is basically a one photograph where one range officer in Ranthambore Tiger Reserve had gone to rescue one tiger from the agriculture field. The tiger attacked the range officer only. So many times it has problems also. And as I told you that there is a conflict with the local people also. It is very difficult to make people understand that animal is also important, because many times when somebody gets killed or somebody's daughter or son or a child gets killed by tiger or elephant, you can't basically console them. You can't console them just by saying word, the tiger is also important. For tiger is important, might be for you, but as a human being, for them, words are important. So these are some of the issues which we face whenever conflict issues are there. And because of this, specific provision is there in Wildlife Protection Act. If you find any animal which has become dangerous to human life, if any animal has become dangerous to human life, that animal may be killed, but by the direction of Chief Wildlife Warden. But those animals are not killed immediately. We try to find out those animals. We try all physical methods to capture that animal from agriculture field to rehabilitate it back into forest area. If we are not able to, that is done mainly by the help of tranquilizing, putting cages. And later on, when we are not able to capture the animal with the help of cages, then we put people for tranquilizing also, And later on, when if it is difficult to tranquilize even, because as I told you that these habitats or these agricultural fields, especially sugarcane fields, are very good wild animal habitat also. If you if the tiger has gone there, you will be surprised to know you will find all the animals also. You will find cheetah, you will find sambar, you will find wild pig there in the sugarcane field. And in the Tarai forest of Uttar Pradesh, in around Dudhwa, people have started calling tigers as sugarcane tiger. So this tiger is a sugarcane tiger. So they have many times they breed in sugarcane field. Newborn cubs are there in sugarcane field. They grow there in sugarcane field only. So these are some of the issues when we have to capture the animal, tranquilize the animal. If at all we are not able to do that even, and still the animal is dangerous to human life, then ultimately we have to eliminate the animal. So this is very important aspect which I wanted to tell you why it is important to kill the animal also sometime. Because for overall conservation of the forest or the particular species, it is very important that that these are the steps which you we have to take to get the confidence of the local people. Otherwise, what will happen? People start poisoning the animals. Okay, suppose in any agriculture field or any adjoining area where there is a small waterhole or water body, people they just put the poison and many animals get killed because of the poisoning. So this is the reason why we have to kill the animal also. Sometimes when it goes beyond our control, it becomes next to impossible to capture the animal. These animals, previously people used to call them man-eater, because recently we have in NTCA, because I have worked in field also, so I took it personally that we should remove this word. In our one of the SOP, the word man-eater was written, whereas in Act, the word like man-eater is not there. So now we have replaced the word man-eater with the word dangerous to human life, which is there in the Wildlife Protection Act also. As I told you that animals will get killed for trade, for recreation, for all those purposes. And there are specific routes which are there. Like if an animal get killed in India, it will go to Nepal, and from Nepal it will go to China or to Southeast Asia. So these are different routes which are there for the animal trade. And in many time, our enforcement agencies, forest department or central or the state forest enforcement agencies, they have been able to catch hold of these international traders also. So over a period of time, this trade has decreased a lot, but it is still there, especially from the countries of Southeast Asia. Then that's why the tiger population in Southeast Asia is not able to be established even now, and most of the tiger population in world is in India only. As far as the people, those who are actually involved in hunting are very poor. They are very poor people because they belong to tribes, and you'll be surprised to know that these people, those who are there, who are sitting along with this tiger skin, they are basically, you'll be surprised to know that these people are from a state which doesn't have any tiger. So there is a tribe in the state of Haryana, Bavariya. So these are Bavariya people who are very expert in killing the tiger or other wild animals, even the snakes and all. And this is the person who was responsible for maximum number of tiger being killed in India, Sansar Chand. He was in prison and went to 7 years of jail, and ultimately he died in jail. And this is one international trader. So this is basically a cycle from a poor person to middleman and to the international trader. But ultimately, who get caught? Most of the time, all these poachers who are basically belong to poor communities or tribes, they get caught. And in many states, the state governments or state forest department, they have started certain rehabilitation and some welfare program for these people. Like there is one community in Madhya Pradesh called Padri. So all these people have been rehabilitated by the state forest department by involving or engaging them in other activities other than hunting. These are some of the ways If you can see this slide with the bamboo stick, this is known as a tiger trap. This is how they kill the animal. So they put these traps in different places, in different maybe around a distance of 50 meter or meter in an area of 1 hectare. They will put around 5-6 traps there, and on the path where the animal moves, and ultimately when the animal put the foot on this, and they get trapped, and ultimately they get killed. So, and if you see this, it's nothing but this. This is another kind of bomb which people use, especially for killing the wild pig. This is known as Sutli bomb. What they do? They put it under the ground and they kill the animal. These are snares or noose wire, which people generally put adjoining to agricultural field for killing basically herbivore species. But many a time tiger also get caught in this. This is in fact very generally, I don't show this picture, but this is how tiger get killed from this tiger traps. This is I think towards my last few slides, but very important aspect. And all those slides which I have shown you about tiger, about the negative aspects of different activities which ultimately lead to negative impact on tiger conservation, this is in present day, if you ask me personally, this is the biggest thing which is acting against the tiger conservation. You know what is happening in most of the areas? The tiger tourism has become unregulated. People go to national park or sanctuary not for the purpose of appreciation of the forest or the wildlife or the floral diversity. They go for sighting the tiger. And if most of the time I say that if at all you want to go to see a tiger, you go to zoo. They sight the tiger. And human behavior and the mobile people, they tend to go as close as possible to animals. And all these resort people, when there is, they call people for all different purposes, like for celebrating the new fixed carrying capacity in forest area. All these areas which are there in adjoining areas of tiger reserves are full with people. And otherwise also they create lots of problem as far as noise or all these things are concerned. But there are certain regulations in that you can with the sound. And if you see in any wilderness area, if animal or the people, they behave like this, it is very good. If the animal is far away, it's very good, it's looking very good. But ultimately what is the actual scene? This picture I took in 2007 or 8 in Kanha National Park. This is the time when somebody saw the tiger, and later on what happens? Just see. This is the picture which I took just after that. So many people, they came together, and you can see all these pictures. So see this picture, how many people are there? More than 100, more than maybe 200 even. So this is the kind of pressure the animals are facing. And due to this, what is happening? The animal behavior is also changing. What is happening over a period of time? The territory of tiger is decreasing, because tiger is a territorial animal. And whenever tiger give birth to the cubs, they give, I think, a litter of four cubs, three cubs. And most of the time, when these three cubs or four cubs, they grow. And many times, and 99% it happens, 99%, 9% happens, that all the tiger cubs, they don't survive. It is either one or two. They survive. Then what is happening now? Because of this lots of tourism, these animal have restricted in, because most of the time you are basically tracking the animal just for the purpose of sighting in tourism area. Maine nahi dekha to kisi dusre ne dekha. And people have mobile, they communicate and they go to the tiger. And what happens? These tigers, which are there as cub, when they grow, they are not able to hunt. Okay. They need free space, they need privacy, and they need time also to learn the hunting techniques. And all these species, when they grow up to 2 years, they are fed by their mother. So when they are fed by their mother, they don't move out. And so what is happening? So most of the time, all these animals which are there, they grow up to 2 years and they don't get killed because of starvation or other factors, because mother is continuously feeding them, because they are not surviving on their own. So what happens? They go out in because ultimately they will find the territory. After 2 years of age, when they move out, they go in agricultural field. So that is how this population dynamics is basically is affected by tourism, and animals becomes very friendly sometimes. So this is one picture which I wanted to show you, that how one should behave in a forest. There are two vehicles and one of my vehicle which was there in the back when I was posted as field director for Corbett Tiger Reserve. So the people or the tourists are or the gypsy driver or the guides, they are so sensitized that the person who is on the is far behind, that person took away his vehicle back that side, and this vehicle took this side. And what happened after some time, when this elephant find the way, it moved into the forest. And most of the time what happens, a tourist from this side will move ahead, tourist from that side will move towards animals, and conflict happens sometimes. Protection is very important. Many time people have to live in forest for continuously for 7 days, 8 days. If you really want to appreciate the efforts of forest department, you must visit. Whenever you go to forest, you must visit one of their forest chowki, and you must talk to the forest staff how they are living, what are the conditions. Like this is a picture of Kaziranga Tiger Reserve, where they construct the raised forest guard camps, because most of the time, or in during the monsoon, all the area is inundated with the water, and they have to do the patrolling with the handmade boats also. So protection is very important aspect, because these areas are vulnerable. And in NTCA, we have taken one more step which is very important. We have moved the area villages from inviolate areas, which are the inviolate areas means the areas which are notified as national park or core area of a tiger reserve. We have moved many villages from national park and sanctuaries to outside areas. So you can see just see the change in habitat which happens just in few years. So it's a win-win situation. Village relocation is a win-win situation for forest as well as for the local people, because now when they move out, they go close to roads, they go close to schools, they go close to dispensary, and they get all those help there. So this was my last slide, because time is also running out. And this is one quote which I generally use in my slides. This is a quote by one author, Aldo Leopold. He says, "We abuse land because we regard it as a commodity belonging to us. Because we regard land as a commodity to us. When we see land as a community to which we belong, we never see that land and human, or basically animal and human, or forest and human, we are basically the same community. We may begin use it with love and respect. Okay, as we love, as we respect human beings, we start having love and respect for the nature and forest or the wild animals also. Thank you very much."
Thank you, Mr. Mehra. Vagisha, I'll take over. Thank you, Mr. Surinder Mehra, for a very informative talk covering all aspects of tiger management challenges, like human-tiger conflict, poaching, and even unregulated ecotourism, which we thought was pretty harmless, and all the initiatives of India to conserve tigers. And in general, the importance of having tiger reserves. For example, when you said that more than 350 rivers originate from the 51 tiger reserves. So how the management has strategically planned to form these reserves, not just for tigers, but also for other animals and other biodiversity and environment in general. So this was really very informative. Sir, you've always been an immense source of knowledge in wildlife management. And we at University of Delhi have always been thankful to you for your contribution in streamlining our wildlife management curriculum, not just during the syllabus formation way back in 2017. But also in helping us conduct the faculty development program to orient Delhi University teachers towards this course. So you've been an integral part of us all through our journey in wildlife management course. And for the participants, I got in touch with Mr. Mehra in 2017. And since then, I've been learning new aspects of wildlife management every time we break into a discussion. His passion for wildlife management, ethics, laws, and policies is contagious. And it has had me bending my research interest towards wildlife management. So thank you so much, sir, for yet again enlightening us with your knowledge and experience. And true to your passion, you have marked a distinct territory in our hearts and minds for wildlife management. Despite still in the hangover of your talk, we now move on from the king of the forest to the conquerors of the sky. I invite my colleague, Dr. Richa Mishra, to introduce Dr. Bhaduri for a very engaging discussion on birds of India. Thank you so much, Mr. Mehra.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Sir, before you leave the screen, although we are running a little late, but if you allow, we can ask few students to ask some questions. They have some queries, so if you'll allow, we will first take up that and then we'll move to our second speaker of the day. I think it will be better, this is Smita, that you unmute yourself and you can ask the question yourself. I think sir would like that more.
Okay, ma'am. Good morning, sir. So I have a question. You said that it is very difficult to manage local people when there is a conflict between the animals and the local people. So I would like to ask, is it possible to educate the local people like how to conserve in such situations rather than panicking? What can they do in order to safeguard themselves and also safeguard the animals when such situations occur? So that is the question. How is it possible to educate them and to safeguard everyone around them?
Yes, good question. In fact, If I put this thing in a different context, that people living around forests, they are more knowledgeable as far as understanding of animal is concerned. But otherwise also, forest department is concerned, we engage people in talks with the help of our eco development committees. All the villages around the tiger reserves, they have eco development committees. A few instances which I've shown you are the extreme instances. This doesn't happen all the time. So most of the time, all these eco-development activities or the committees, eco-development committees, they are very active in management and engage themselves with the management of adjoining area. Adjoining area means the adjoining to forest. In many areas, we have been able to bring the conflict to zero level also. Like there is one village in Kobe Tiger Reserve, which we fenced with the help of solar fencing. And within a time of 1 year from conflicts, that particular village was mainly suffering the conflict from elephant. We brought it down to zero. But many times it becomes very difficult when there are certain stray animals, but the animal behavior is also different. Because as I told you that they have the agriculture field like sugarcane. Mostly we face the conflict there. Or when the animal is moving from one area to another area in bigger landscape. So these are very few instances when we. But otherwise also, you know, if you ask me to put it in a different way, that if something happens in a city, okay, some accident happens. People get around that place. They will make a mob in few minutes, and nobody will try to help out the person who has met an accident. So that is the kind of mentality when people they start getting into the mob. So these are few situations when we when the situation become very difficult. But otherwise, as far as the local people are concerned, forest department, we get lots of help from the local people, and to have the engagement of talk, and many a time they help in telling the forest department also that the particular animal has, they have in their agriculture field, and then the forest department, they go there and they capture the animal. This type of situation happen when there are lots of damage to the human life, like the few photograph or the newspaper clipping which I have shown to you, that happened after nine human killings by the tiger. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. I think, yeah, Mrigank and Mansi, you can ask your question one by one. You can unmute yourself.
Yes, ma'am. Sir, my question is, how do I explain to people the importance of wildlife and conservation who do not share the same background as we do? Like, my friends, my engineers, when I say ki why wildlife is important and there is importance of a forest, they say ki to abandoned area and se clear karke yahan pe dam bana do ya fir koi bridge bana do. They don't just realize its importance. So how do I convince them?
Like, I give you one live example, because myself, I'm also an engineer. So a best example to tell in your case, as you told that one of the engineer you talked about, your friend, suppose he is a civil engineer. He is engaged in construction of dam. So when we construct a dam, what is the basic requirement? Basic requirement is water. So what happens? The water is basically coming from the river, and that river, when they flow, they bring lots of silt also along with the flow of water. And if we don't conserve the forest in the catchment area of that dam, what will happen? Suppose the expected life of a dam is 30 years. I'm sure if you don't do the catchment area treatment within 10 years, that dam will be silted. So this is one aspect. And this is just an example how you can tell people why it is important for the like, suppose I'll give you another example. Even a normal person, few days back, around a month back or so, there was one tragedy in Uttarakhand. One disaster happened in Uttarakhand, and thereafter, what happened in New Delhi area? After I think 3 or 4 or 5 days, after 5 days of that disaster in New Delhi area, the water supply was restricted. And you know why that happened? Because when that devastation happened, lots of silt came, and all the purifying plant of Delhi Jal Board, they stopped working. So these are small examples, and these are, there's nothing rocket science in that, but otherwise also, these are very scientific logic behind all these things. So if you're interacting with a person who is educated, then it should not be very difficult to make them understand. But you should use the right example. You should not say that, okay, elephant is very beautiful or the tiger is very beautiful, they should survive. You and me, who belong to a particular community of a field of education, we can understand that each and every life or life form has a right to live. But not a person who is engaged, who is in engineering background, or he is in different, who is a chartered accountant. They won't be able to understand. But these are some of the examples which I think are very important, and should be included in our course curriculums also, and not in schools but in colleges. So these are important aspects which make people understand why forests are important.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. I think that was very helpful. I think now Mansi can continue with her question.
Right. Hello, sir. Namaskar. Sir,
थैंक यू फॉर योर टॉक. और जब मैं आपकी टॉक सुन रही थी और मैं सोच रही थी तो मेरी नज़र मेरी नोटबुक पे पड़ी. दिस इज माई फेवरेट नोटबुक और इस पर एक टाइगर बना और इस बार ही थोड़ा अलग से स्ट्राइक किया ये टाइगर की फोटो. तो सर आपकी टॉक से मेरी रिफ्लेक्शन ये है कि मेरे को एक इंस्पिरेशन है टू सॉल्व द प्रॉब्लम ऑफ वाइल्ड लाइफ ट्रेड. तो मैं इस पर सोचूंगी थोड़ा और. बट मेरा आपसे क्वेश्चन ये था कि I hope to work for a couple of years in wildlife and conservation ahead. So, क्या मेरे लिए एक यही direction है कि I go into wildlife research या फिर मैं कुछ और कर सकती हूँ?
There are many ways to engage yourself in wildlife conservation, especially from your point of view. If you have core interest, then you can definitely go for research, or maybe you can go for PG also if you are not. If you are just a graduate, and you can go for PhD also in this field, because now there are lots of institutes within India and outside India, they are engaging people in for the research. But otherwise, if you really are not interested as a profession, you are not interested to go in the wildlife conservation, then you can go for some internship with the universities, or maybe some NGOs, some good NGOs, like if you are talking about the tiger or the trade of wild animals, there is one NGO called Traffic India, which is a subsidiary NGO of WWF. They are doing a very good work in data analysis and this tiger or animal trade also, international trade. They are doing a good job in this, so you can engage yourself as an intern or maybe on permanent basis for a few years. So many people in India or in world, they change their profession. Maybe 5 years you work here, 5 years you work there. That is another interesting aspect which people are following these days, so that you have a very good idea by the time you are mature enough, or you want to basically teach your children, or basically do something for the society. You have a basic or a fair idea of all different aspects of the life or different aspects of the fields. And there are many forest departments which are very good in this, like in curbing the wildlife trade. States like Uttarakhand, Madhya Pradesh, and Maharashtra, they have their own unit. They have their own wildlife animal trade units. You can get engaged with them. And at national level, we have Wildlife Crime Control Bureau also. You can associate with them also as an intern or as a part-time researcher. So this is how you can engage yourself for the time being if you are not basically looking wildlife conservation as a full-fledged profession.
Thank you. That was very helpful. Thank you, sir.
The next participant can ask the question. Mr. Ram Naresh Dara.
हेलो सर, थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर द टॉक. सर मेरा क्वेश्चन ये है कि सर जो लोग इस सब्जेक्ट से रिलेटेड हैं, जो जूलॉजी से कर रहे जो भी एंड जिनका ग्रेजुएशन में ये है वो तो सर नॉलेज होता है, लेकिन सर जो अदर फील्ड से हैं, जैसे कि मैं मैथ से हूँ एंड सर जो जनरल स्टूडेंट्स हैं सर, उनका क्या रोल है सर वाइल्ड लाइफ कंजर्वेशन में, और सर हम कैसे कॉन्ट्रीब्यूट कर सकते कि हमारा सर सब्जेक्ट भी नहीं एंड सर हमें मतलब वैसे कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशन क्या हो सकता है सर हमारा, उस लिए बताइए सर.
बहुत कंट्रीब्यूशन हो सकता है राम नरेश, क्योंकि देखिए हम इफ यू रीड कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन आर्टिकल 48, इट सेज दैट इट इज द डायरेक्टिव प्रिंसिपल फॉर द स्टेट पॉलिसी आल्सो एंड 52 द फंडामेंटल ड्यूटी. ये हर एक सिटीजन या हर एक नागरिक का कर्तव्य है वो देश का जंगल और देश के जो जंगल में रहने वाले वन्य जीव है उनके प्रति वो संवेदना रखें और उनका वो संरक्षण करें. बहुत सारे तरीके मैं आपको छोटा सा एग्जांपल देता हूँ. अगर आप कंट्रीब्यूट करना चाहें तो बहुत कुछ कर सकते हैं. अगर आपके मन में है कि वाइल्ड लाइफ कंजर्वेशन होना चाहिए, मैथमेटिक्स बैकग्राउंड की है, तो क्या हुआ जहां पर आप रहते हैं वहां पर जब आप लोगों से बात करते हैं, अगर आप एक महीने में यदि एक व्यक्ति को भी अगर आप मोटिवेट कर पाए सिर्फ ये सोचने के लिए कि उनको भी कुछ नहीं करना, ना आपको कुछ करना है ना उस व्यक्ति को कुछ करना है, कि फॉरेस्ट क्यों इंपॉर्टेंट है और वाइल्ड लाइफ क्यों इंपॉर्टेंट है, अगर आप उनको बता पाते हैं ये बहुत बड़ी बात है। क्योंकि हो सकता है कि वो पर्टिकुलर इंडिविजुअल फ्यूचर में जाके किसी ऐसी पॉलिसी पे बात करे या उसको कोई ऐसा डिसीजन लेना हो जहां पर ये मैटर करता हो कि फॉरेस्ट को बचाना है या वो काम करना है, तो वो मैटर करेगा। मैं आपको एग्जांपल देता हूँ। जब मैं फील्ड पोस्टेड था तो हम लोगों ने एक बच्चों के लिए प्रोग्राम किया, अवेयरनेस का प्रोग्राम किया। उसके बाद 10-12 दिन बाद मेरे पास एक फोन आया उनमें से एक बच्चे का, तो उन्होंने अपने पेरेंट्स की शिकायत की कि मेरे जो फादर हैं वो इस नदी में जाते हैं बार बार और वो ना फिशिंग करके आते हैं। तो मैंने कहा फिशिंग तो उस एरिया में वैसे भी होती थी फॉर लाइवलीहुड पर्पज, तो मैंने कहा इसमें क्या गलत है, वो तो अपने उसके लिए घर में बनाने के लिए लाते होंगे। तो उन्होंने जनरली आई यूज डिफरेंट कोड, वन फ्रॉम महात्मा गांधी ऑल्सो, रिसोर्सेज आर देयर फॉर योर नीड बट नॉट फॉर योर ग्रीड। तो उन्होंने वही बोला कि वो घर में बनाने के लिए नहीं लाते हैं, वो पहले घर में बनाने के लिए लाते थे, अब वो बाजार में जाके बेचने भी लगे हैं उसको। तो अगर जब आप किसी दूसरे व्यक्ति को बताते हैं, जब एक बच्चा समझ सकता है, और आज नहीं तो कल कभी ना कभी ये चीज किसी व्यक्ति के भी काम आती है। ऐसा नहीं है कि अगर हम उस फील्ड में जाएंगे तभी हम काम कर सकते हैं। तो अगर जैसे मैं आप लोगों से बात कर रहा हूँ, आप लोग जब दूसरे लोगों से बात करते हैं और आपको भी याद आएगा कभी कोई जो फील्ड आपका नहीं है उस फील्ड के बारे में यदि किसी दूसरे व्यक्ति ने आपको कुछ बताया हो, अगर आपको एकदम से याद आता है, और कई बार हमारे ऐसे डिसीजन होते हैं कि हमें एकदम से याद आता है उस व्यक्ति ने ये बताया तो हमारा डिसीजन चेंज होता है। तो अवेयरनेस बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट चीज है, खाली वो सिर्फ डायरेक्ट टारगेट ग्रुप के लिए नहीं, किसी के लिए भी हो सकती है।
मैं आई वुड लाइक टू इंटरवीन हियर। रामनरेश, मैं आपको बताना चाहती हूँ कि ये मिस्टर मेहरा जो है ये बीटेक है इलेक्ट्रॉनिक्स में। ही स्टार्टेड हिज करियर एज अ बैचलर्स बीटेक इन इलेक्ट्रॉनिक्स, सो ही इज डन हिज बीटेक एंड आफ्टर दैट ही इज कम टू वाइल्ड लाइफ। अभी तो आप अंडर ग्रेजुएट लेवल पे हो, आप यू कैन चूज एनीथिंग यू लाइक, यू कैन टेक अप योर पैशन।
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, sir. समझ गया सर। Yes, thank you very much.
Yeah, Madhav and Neeraj, you wanted to ask something?
Yes, ma'am. Sir, thank you very much for the talk. It was very informative. Sir, I had a question. Sir, you mentioned that the behavior of tiger is changing due to human interference and fragmentation and the way the tourists behave. So, sir, I wanted to ask, due to fragmentation, is the tiger reducing the area of territory it maintains so that its offspring can also maintain a territory within the same habitat, or is there increased conflict between the tigers?
ये आपका बहुत important question है। In fact, हम लोग काफी इस बारे में बात भी करते हैं आजकल। डेफिनेटली जब एनिमल बिहेवियर चेंज होता है तो और टाइगर नंबर भी बढ़ता है एंड यू डोंट हैव स्पेस, तो जो टाइगर का टेरिटरी है वो भी कम होता है। और जब टाइगर का नंबर बढ़ता है, एक चीज़ और मैं आप लोगों को बताना चाहूँगा, किसी भी स्पीसीज का कंजर्वेशन का मतलब ये नहीं है कि हम उसकी संख्या बढ़ाते रहें। तो देर शुड बी लिमिट, है ना। एक देर इज थ्योरी इन इकोनॉमिक्स कॉल्ड लिमिट्स टू ग्रोथ। हर एक चीज का लिमिट टू ग्रोथ होता है। तो एक पर्टिकुलर नंबर तक तो हम जा सकते हैं टाइगर में भी, उसके बियॉन्ड नहीं जाने की कोशिश करना चाहिए हमें भी। अब टाइगर नंबर इज इन इंडिया इज क्वाइट गुड, इफ यू आर एबल टू प्रोटेक्ट दिस नंबर ऑल्सो दिस इज वेरी गुड फॉर कंट्री। बिकॉज अगर आप एक पर्टिकुलर लेवल से ऊपर अगर आप हैबिटेट को भी चेंज करते रहेंगे, हैबिटेट चेंज मतलब कई कारणों से टाइगर का नंबर बढ़ता है, एनिमल बिहेवियर से तो बढ़ता ही है, लेकिन उससे ज्यादा जो एनिमल का जो टेरिटरी है वो कम इसलिए भी होती है। हैबिटेट देखिए, जो नेचुरल हैबिटेट होता है उसमें जरूरी नहीं कि हर जगह ग्रास हो, हर जगह पानी हो, हर जगह पेड़ हो। तो इन सब चीजों के लिए जो टाइगर है या बाकी स्पीसीज है उनको चलना पड़ता है, बहुत दूर दूर तक जाना पड़ता है, और टाइगर की तो टेरिटरी होती है। और मेनी टाइम हम लोगों ने बहुत सारे एरियाज में, हमने ओवर एंथुजियाज्म में भी, मैं कई बार बोलता हूँ फॉरेस्ट डिपार्टमेंट्स को भी, ओवर एंथुजियाज्म में हमने अपने हैबिटेट्स को भी चेंज किया है, ग्रासलैंड बढ़ा दिए या वाटर होल बना दिए बहुत सारे। देन व्हाट हैपेंस, जब ये करते हैं तो जो हर्बीवोर स्पीसीज है उनका नंबर बढ़ता है, उसके साथ साथ टाइगर का नंबर भी बढ़ता है, और वो बहुत कम स्पेस में ज्यादा टाइगर भी सर्वाइव करते हैं क्योंकि आपकी टेरिटरी कम हो गई उसके बाद। तो आई जनरली सी टू एरियाज उत्तराखंड में, जैसे कॉर्बेट टाइगर रिजर्व है उसमें टाइगर की जो डेंसिटी है वर्ल्ड में सबसे ज्यादा है, हालांकि उसके आसपास का भी लैंडस्केप है। और उसी तरह से वहां पर एक नंदोर वाइल्ड लाइफ सेंचुरी है, अगर आप एज ए टूरिस्ट वहां जाएंगे आपको कभी टाइगर नहीं दिखेगा, आप किसी भी तरह से जाए, गाड़ी से चले जाए, पैदल चले जाए, बोट में चले जाए, आपको टाइगर नहीं दिखेगा। बट इफ यू पुट कैमरा ट्रैप आपको सब जगह टाइगर दिखाई देगा, बट वहां का नंबर बहुत ज्यादा नहीं है। लेकिन अगर आप बाकी जगह जाएं जहां नेशनल पार्क या सेंचुरीज हैं, टूरिज्म बहुत ज्यादा है और प्रोटेक्शन का लेवल भी बहुत ज्यादा है, तो और जहां टाइगर की टेरिटरी भी बहुत कम है, वहां बहुत ज्यादा एनिमल दिखते हैं। तो इसलिए बहुत जरूरी है कि हमें इस चीज पर नहीं जाना है कि टाइगर का नंबर ज्यादा हो, पॉपुलेशन, टोटल पॉपुलेशन हेल्दी हो वो ज्यादा इंपॉर्टेंट है, फॉरेस्ट प्रोटेक्टेड रहे वो ज्यादा इंपॉर्टेंट है। तो ये बात आपकी बिल्कुल सही है और इस दिशा में हम लोग काम भी कर रहे हैं। आने वाले समय में हम ये कोशिश कर रहे हैं कि जितने भी टाइगर रिजर्व्स हैं वो अपने दिमाग में से ये कॉन्सेप्ट अब धीरे धीरे निकालने की कोशिश करें कि हमें टाइगर का नंबर बढ़ाना है। टाइगर का नंबर एक स्टेबल नंबर होना चाहिए जो कि वो पर्टिकुलर हैबिटेट उसको मैनेज कर सके, सर्वाइव कर सके इन लॉन्ग रन। ऐसा नहीं है कि टाइगर का नंबर आपका हो गया, उसके बाद क्या होता है कि टाइगर का नंबर जब बहुत ज्यादा होता है टेरिटरी बहुत कम होती है, आपने भी पढ़ा भी होगा कि उसके बाद जब सारे एनिमल सर्वाइव करते हैं तो नेचर में कॉन्सेप्ट है सर्वाइवल ऑफ फिटेस्ट। अगर सर्वाइवल ऑफ फिटेस्ट नहीं है, अगर सर्वाइवल ऑफ ऑल है वहां पर भी, जैसे लोगों की तरह ह्यूमन पॉपुलेशन में होता है सर्वाइवल ऑफ ऑल है ना, हम बचपन से इंजेक्शन लगाते हैं और वैक्सीनेशन करते हैं तो लाइफ एक्सपेक्टेंसी भी बहुत ज्यादा बढ़ती है। तो लेकिन जब पैंडेमिक होता है कुछ होता है तो फिर वो जो डैमेज है वो भी बहुत ज्यादा बड़ा होता है। इन द सेम वे अगर वो देर आर सो मेनी वायरस बैक्टीरिया कितने होते हैं जंगल में, लेकिन जंगल में पॉपुलेशन क्रैश नहीं करती है। पॉपुलेशन जंगल में क्रैश तब करती है कि जो उनका जो पॉपुलेशन है अगर वो इफ इट इज मोर लाइक ए कैप्टिव ब्रेड, अगर आप जू में कोई डिजीज होगी तो वो तुरंत स्प्रेड होगी, लेकिन अगर जंगल में होगा तो इतनी आसानी से स्प्रेड नहीं होगी क्योंकि वहां जेनेटिक वेरिएशन है बहुत, बेसिकली वहां पर जब इनब्रीडिंग नहीं है। तो इसलिए बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट है कि हमारे जो नेशनल पार्क या सेंचुरीज हैं खाली पॉपुलेशन बहुत ज्यादा ना हो, एक हेल्दी पॉपुलेशन होना बहुत जरूरी है।
थैंक यू सर।
सर थैंक यू सर।
नीरज कैन वी जस्ट क्विकली यू कैन आस्क योर क्वेश्चन, दिस विल बी लास्ट वन, आई एम श्योर सर वुड टेक अप, यू कैन गेट इन टच विद हिम अगेन, but our second speaker is also yes. waiting, so we'd like to move on also. Neeraj, can you quickly ask your question?
Yes sir. Good morning sir. Sir, as you said, there are more than 350 rivers which originates or pass through tiger reserves. So one major problem that is in congruence with rivers are flooding, right, which affects the animal including tigers, though tigers are good swimmers. So I want to ask, what are the challenges for you people during the flooding season for conserving wildlife? Or try is sawal par aur main vistrit roshni dalu to jo insaan hum log to uncha sthal dhoond lete hain jaise bhi flooding aati hai, par usi samay par jo vanya jeev jantu hain, vanya jeev jantu aur tiger hain, wo bhi usi unche sthan par jaane ki koshish karte hain, to us samay bhi human animal conflict badh jata hai, to is par aapki kya raaye hai?
नीरज, जो आपका सवाल है इसका जवाब मैंने शायद पिछले सवाल में दिया है और वो मैं आपके सवाल से उसको लिंक करते हुए इस तरह से रखूंगा कि जो वाइल्ड एनिमल्स हैं, कोई भी वाइल्ड एनिमल हो, कोई भी इतनी बड़ी नेचुरल कैलेमिटी, फ्लडिंग इज नॉट सच अ बिग नेचुरल कैलेमिटी फॉर एनिमल्स। और वो कैलेमिटी मालूम है कब होती है? वो कैलेमिटी तब होती है जब हमने उस लैंडस्केप को या उसको जो हैबिटेट है उसको हमने मॉडिफाई कर दिया हो। जैसे आप लोग देखेंगे कि बहुत सारी जो रिवर्स हैं उनको हमने बहुत ज्यादा चैनलाइज कर दिया, रिवर हैं या स्ट्रीम्स हैं, और जितने भी जो हमारे फ्लड प्लेन्स हैं वो जो 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 नाले होते हैं, आप ये देखिए एग्रीकल्चर कहाँ तक होता है, अगर आप कभी उत्तर प्रदेश में या किसी ऐसे एरिया में जाएं जहां पर छोटी छोटी नदियां हैं, बिल्कुल छोटी छोटी नदियां हैं जो सिर्फ मानसून के समय में पानी आता है, बाकी टाइम में क्या होता है आप देखें, बिल्कुल बीच में एक छोटी सी पट्टी होती है, बाकी सारे में एग्रीकल्चर होता है। तो उससे क्या हुआ है ओवर अ पीरियड ऑफ टाइम, वो फ्लडिंग का मेन रीजन भी हुआ है। फ्लडिंग का रीजन ये नहीं कि ज्यादा बारिश हो गई, फ्लडिंग का मेन रीजन अभी जैसे डिवास्टेशन जो वहां पर आया उत्तराखंड में, तो उसका रीजन ये नहीं है कि वो पानी आ गया ऊपर से, पानी तो आता ही है वहां पर, है ना, नेचुरल तो प्रोसेस है ना, तो लेकिन क्योंकि वहां पर बीच में ऑब्स्ट्रक्शन था, तो जब भी कभी ऑब्स्ट्रक्शन होता है तो जो पानी है वो इट विल ऑलवेज ट्राई टू फाइंड इट्स वे, तो उसको पानी को तो जगह चाहिए कहीं ना कहीं जाने की, तो जब पानी फैलता है तो तब दिक्कत होती है, लेकिन जो जंगल के एरियाज हैं वहां पर कभी भी वाइल्ड एनिमल्स को फ्लडिंग से बहुत ज्यादा दिक्कत नहीं होती है। देर आर फ्यू एरियाज लाइक काजीरंगा, काजीरंगा में जरूर ऐसा है कि वहां पर जानवरों को थोड़ी दिक्कत इसलिए होती है क्योंकि वहां पर भी हमने सेम तरह से लैंडस्केप को चेंज कर दिया है। अगर आप काजीरंगा का ब्रह्मपुत्रा लैंडस्केप देखेंगे तो जो काजीरंगा के नीचे की तरफ टुवर्ड्स बेसिकली यू कैन से टुवर्ड्स वेस्ट ऑफ काजीरंगा, वेस्ट साउथ वेस्ट ऑफ काजीरंगा, वहां पर उन्होंने जो ब्रह्मपुत्रा रिवर है उसको दोनों तरफ से चैनलाइज किया हुआ है, एक तरह से हैबिटेशन भी है वहां पर और उसके ऊपर काजीरंगा है। तो व्हाट हैपेंस, क्योंकि वहां तो पानी फैल नहीं सकता, तो जो काजीरंगा का एरिया है सारा पानी वहीं फैलता है ना, तो जहां पर क्योंकि काजीरंगा तो नेचुरल लैंडस्केप है, तो जो पानी वहां पर जहां पर थोड़ा थोड़ा सब जगह फैलना चाहिए था, मान लीजिए 100 किलोमीटर के स्ट्रेच में फैलना चाहिए था, वो जो पानी है अगर वो सिर्फ 10 किलोमीटर के स्ट्रेच में फैल रहा है तो ऑब्वियसली वो बहुत दूर तक जाएगा, है ना। अगर 100 किलोमीटर के स्ट्रेच में फैलता है तो वो फ्लड प्लेन तक ही रहता। तो ऐसे में काजीरंगा टाइगर रिजर्व में काफी सारे हाईलैंड्स भी बनाए जाते हैं आजकल और काफी सारे ऐसे रोड्स हैं जो वी कंस्ट्रक्ट ड्यूरिंग द नॉर्मल टाइम फॉर विच आर यूज फॉर पेट्रोलिंग, विच आर यूज फॉर टूरिज्म ऑल्सो, विच आर बेसिकली रेल्स, जो वहाँ के रोड्स हैं काजीरंगा के वो रेल्स हैं। और उसी तरह से कुछ काफी सारे आइलैंड जो हैं वो रेल्स आइलैंड भी बनाते हैं। ये दिस इज वेरी स्पेसिफिक विद काजीरंगा, यू शुड नॉट और यू कैन नॉट ट्राई ऑल दीज मेथड्स और मेथडोलॉजी इन अदर नेशनल पार्क।
Okay, sir. Thank you so much.
I hope I could answer you.
Yes, sir.
Okay, Neeraj.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for taking out time and to interact with all of us and share your knowledge. And we always look forward to hearing you and getting to know more and more about wildlife conservation. Thank you so much, sir, for.